In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia! Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. The first time I celebrated an Ascension Mass, it was in those days when whole schools would come to church on the Ascension if they didn't have the day off. So I had a church full of children, and inevitably I used the old story of the incense rising to heaven. What is this? If this is a funeral, what's inside it? Incense. What comes out of it? Smoke. And where does the smoke go? It goes over there. No, it doesn't. It goes up. And it brings our prayers, the symbolic of our prayers. It's symbolic of everything that we are. And it rises as Christ rose, because when Christ rose in his ascension, he took us with him. He has gone there so that we can be at the right hand of God with him. And he has handed over to us the work of preparation, the work of the kingdom. As the period which has become known as My Kingdom Come begins, we should be reminded it's our work to bring about the kingdom, and lifted up in our hearts to him, we have to be fruitful on earth, as the great Easter hymn tells us. Our hearts are in heaven, but our feet are on earth, our hands are on earth, our voices are very real. We are Christ for today. And so, in this Mass, when he joins us in word and sacrament to make that possible, when he makes it possible for us to be him, not just for him, not just on his behalf, but to be him today, let us ask forgiveness for the times when our faith has failed. Let us ask forgiveness for the times when our hearts have not been in heaven. And most of all, let us ask forgiveness for the times when we have not served as he served here on earth. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son, Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that as we believe your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to have ascended into the heavens, so we in heart and mind may also ascend, and with him continually dwell, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote a book about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days, and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud tore him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hear the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised, so stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple, blessing God. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. There is an episode of Tom and Jerry called, if memory serves, The Invisible Mouse, where Jerry the mouse discovers a bottle of invisible ink, which hilariously renders him invisible and and able to inflict all manner of torments on Tom the cat. Being able to appear and disappear at will has, of course, been the dream of many in every age. The Harry Potter idea of an invisibility cloak is hardly a new one, although if you wear shoes with quiet soles and are able to walk gently, invisibility is attainable in many cases in the here and now, and the surprise when you appear out of nowhere is far more satisfying. The elusive nature of the risen Christ offers both joy and frustration to his followers, and it remains a cause of frustration and joy to us today. We are asked to believe that he appeared in flesh and blood to his disciples. Though that flesh and blood could appear and vanish at will, and he was able to get through locked doors. The accounts we have heard today, both of them the work of St. Luke, in some ways put an end to this puzzling period with an apparently staged grand disappearance into the sky. So what are we to make of it? Did it really happen? Was it a dream or a product of a fertile imagination? And each year on Ascension Day, we end up wondering what to make of the feet disappearing into the clouds. This isn't the first generation to ask such questions. It's quite common today to assume that this is the first age that have had any questions at all about the literal sense of Scripture, and that everyone that has gone before just simply believed what it said in every detail. And yes, there are people and places, many of them, who do the same today. But most traditional methods of understanding Scripture, however, are not weighed down by the literal assumptions of uncritical scientific method, but in the best traditions of both faith and science, they ask the question instead, what does it mean? We could, of course, get completely weighed down by trying to work out what the resurrection appearances, of which the Ascension is, of course, the final one, what they actually mean. But that would simply leave us still puzzled and still doing little else than telling a story that would appear to some to be a nice fairy story and to others to be the sad imaginings of people determined to think that they know some esoteric truth not available to the rest of humankind. Yes, we could get weighed down by all that. But where would that get us? What would we learn? Would we be any nearer the truth, which Jesus promises will set us free? The basis of the whole thing goes something like this. Jesus died a criminal's death. He was seen alive by witnesses who were widely disbelieved. He was then taken away. We can't see him today. The meaning of all this is seen in the difference Jesus makes in your life and in mine. The elusive presence of Jesus from the resurrection to the ascension pales into insignificance when compared with his elusiveness at the present day. People quite reasonably ask at times like this, things like, where is your God in all this? And I read last week that some survey suggested that two-thirds of Christians thought that God is saying something to us through COVID-19. What exactly God was trying to say, no one was able or willing to suggest. The reality is that throughout these resurrection appearances, Jesus is giving his followers strength and courage to continue his work. The church has always seen itself as the continuance of the incarnation and the resurrection, in theological terms, as a sacrament of the presence of Jesus. This means that both in worship and service, in the proclamation of the word and the continuation of the sacrifice of the cross, the Church's role in this current age is simply to be the presence of Christ. If the question is asked, where is God? The answer is down to the Church. And if the answer is obscure, or unclear, or contradictory, then the Church is at fault. This is the measure by which we should be judging ourselves today. The Ascension, symbolic or otherwise, is a handing over of the baton, and we are still meant to be running with it. Yet I haven't noticed too much of the Church asking people in the streets or in their homes, what would we have to do to be the presence of God for you? There is a strongly self-referential element to the Church of today, as there has been in every age, and there is a reluctance to take seriously the very old teaching expressed so eloquently during World War II by Archbishop Temple, that the Church is the only society that exists for the benefit of those who are not its members. Above all, on this Ascension Day then, let us recall that Jesus has told us, "You will be my witnesses," and ask ourselves what more can we do, not only to give our witness to the world, but also to ensure the witness is authentic by becoming ever closer to Him. Let us also ask each other the question put to the apostles by the men in white robes. Why do you stand looking up to heaven? He will come again. And the way He will come again today is in you and in me. As long as we stop idly gazing and get on with the work of being God's presence in God's world. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation He came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate, He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. We are asked today to pray for the Thy Kingdom Come global prayer movement, of which today we are a part. In the Anglican Communion cycle of prayer, we pray for the dioceses of Namirembe in the Anglican Church of Uganda, Abia in the Anglican Church of Southern Sudan, and Accra in the Anglican Church of West Africa. church leaders, for our archbishops, for Pope Francis, for the moderators and leaders of free churches, and especially for our bishop living. We pray for all who are sick from coronavirus, and all who have asked our prayers, remembering Sarah Fields, John Doherty, Paul Taylor, James Stretton, Kenneth Hughes, Robin Glasson, Jean Knox, Jane Austin, Charlize Kane, John Robinson, Sheila Laverick, Carol Keenan, John Lydgate, Teddy, Laura, Ian McKenzie, David Staines, Jane Jackson, Jean Maiden, Sue Hastings, Patricia Mitchell, June Franklin, John Herring, and Michael Catton. And as we remember those who have gone before us in faith, we pray for those who have died of coronavirus in the Royal Hospital, elsewhere in this community, and throughout this nation and the world. We pray on her year's mind for Peggy Coulson, and we pray for the recently departed by name, for Eileen Marriott, Shirley Palmer, Anthony Justin Stretton, Carol Denman, Jenny Urruti, Brian Hoskin Priest, and Ian Gaunt. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have exalted your Son Christ Jesus to your right hand, and made him the head over all things for his body, the Church. Hear us as we pray for the Church throughout the world. Make us and all your people receptive to the gifts he pours upon us, that we may use them to your glory and the building up of the body of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God Almighty, the Ancient of Days, you have given your Son all authority in heaven and on earth. Hear us as we pray for the world he came to redeem. Grant that we may know even in this time the things that make for peace, and may strive for the reconciliation of all people in his kingdom of justice and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father of all, whose Son has promised to be with us always to the end of the age, hear us as we pray for those among whom we live and work. Grant that we may be so aware of his presence with us that people may take note of us that we have been with Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, our Redeemer, whose Son ever lives to make intercession, hear us as we pray for those in any kind of need. May he who has borne our infirmities strengthen and heal them, that they may find grace to help in time of need, and rejoice in his salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, whose Son has borne our humanity into the heavenly realms, and gone before us to prepare a place for us, hear us as we remember before you those whose earthly sojourn is over, and whose life is now hidden in him with you. Make us joyful and expectant, that at his coming with all his own, we too may go forth to meet him, and share in his eternal joy. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Alleluia, the peace of the risen and ascended Lord be always with you.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and
us pray for the coming of the kingdom as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the
Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia! God our Father, you have raised our humanity in Christ and have fed us with the bread of heaven. Mercifully grant that nourished with such spiritual blessings, we may set our hearts in the heavenly places through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And to that prayer, as I ask God's blessing upon all of us, I could add, and our feet, hands. of the intercessions touched me a little when we prayed that those with whom we work, those we see day by day, may know of us that we have been with Christ. And we have, wherever we are, however we have joined in, been truly with Christ today. Let us pray that we will be truly for Christ and in him as we continue to serve him and to carry out the task he has given to us to build his kingdom and to allow him to live in and with us. Spirit be among you and remain